define what you mean by godly words and human words. Because God, do you agree that God speaks to people through human understanding? Words, English words, Arabic words, Spanish words.
Words in Arabic cannot be translated in English.
Okay.
Our vocabulary is different. Words back then would never translate into English words now. The meaning in English has no meaning as the meaning in Arabic.
Oh my people, indeed you have wronged yourselves by taking on the calf for worship. So repent to your creator and kill yourselves. You were just about to tell me exactly.
No, repent.
Because,
repent,
one second.
Kill yourself.
No, that's what it says. Look.
This book here was written by three American women, Sahih International. Even they say there's errors in this book. Sahih International.
I agree.
One second, let me talk.
Notice what you said. You said that it won't be the same meaning, but they should...
No.
One second. You said that it won't be the same meaning as the Arabic, but yet they should still read it to understand the Quran. How does that make sense?
Right, cool, rolling, action.
Okay, so this is Anas.
Yes.
Okay, we've agreed to have a discussion about Christ. So I do have a few questions, of course, as a Muslim.
Yes.
Answer the best you can. Don't feel pressured or anything that.
Yep.
Your presupposition, of course, is that Jesus was a Muslim, yeah?
No, he was a Jew.
No, but he was a Muslim prophet.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So if he was a Muslim, I'd ask a few questions. If he was a Muslim, we should find him praying like a Muslim. You know, many Muslims will say that he bowed down like a Muslim. Do you understand?
Okay, cool. But one thing I'd answer to that is basically each prophet come at a certain time for each nation, and each nation had their own book and their own way to follow. So what we do is we believe that all the prophets come from Allah. They're all Muslim. Yeah, they're all prophets of God. So if I'm a Muslim, I believe in Allah.
Okay.
So they're all prophets, right?
Yeah.
And each prophet come to each nation with the same message.
Gotcha.
But they all come with a different... It's like when you play sports now, each sports has... It's all sports, but each sports has its own way of playing it. Do you know what I mean? So, but it's nothing... It's just an example.
Yeah, I understand that.
But so they come at a different time to us. We live in the 21st century. They lived in the,
of course,
you know, back then.
Yeah,
so deserts and everything, buildings.
Yeah.
So they had different ways of praying. And because their time was different, they had certain limits and certain things they can and can't do. Do you know what I mean? Because they were on a mission to spread a message, they had limited time to do things. So each nation had their own way of praying and doing things, but it's all the same.
Gotcha.
Do you know what I mean?
Okay, yeah. So I would say that particular point you addressed at the end and at the beginning, you said that they all preach the same message.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to ask you this, because the earliest accounts of the life of Christ is the New Testament. Okay.
Yeah.
So the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, they are the only four Gospels that take us back to the first century, to the time of Christ, okay? There are other Gospels that come later, but they're too far later to be considered actually authentic to the author. So New Testament scholars like Michael Kruger, he will admit that the only four Gospels that do take us back to the time of the apostles were Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. But actually some of the epistles of Paul were even earlier, do you understand?
Okay, can I ask you a question?
Can I just
okay, sorry. I thought you were...
No, so I would say that when we look at those accounts of Christ, because you said they all taught the same message,
yeah.
They all preach the same message. But if we look at the earliest accounts of Christ and look at the message he did preach, he said very different things to what we see in the Quran. For example, in the Quran, I believe it's chapter 6 and a couple of other places, it says that Allah is not the father of Jesus.
Yeah.
But when we see Jesus, even in his prayer life, he addresses God as his father each and every time. For example, you have the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who... One second.
Okay,
Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, I would say this. If he was just a Muslim prophet, he could not have prayed in that way. Do you understand? And also, if he has the same message as the other prophets, I have to disagree, because the message that Christ came with was that he was going to be crucified. So when we look at the message of Christ, it's very different from the prophets of Islam. Do you understand?
Yeah, but one thing I'd say to you like that, yeah, is when he refers to God as a father, yeah, he doesn't refer to him as how I refer to my father, as in he's my dad. He refers to him as a majestic father, as in the almighty creator, not as in his own father, his dad. And secondly, he comes down to earth and he says, worship my Lord and your Lord. So how can he be the son of God if he's...
Good question.
He's asking the people, he goes, worship my Lord and your Lord. Whereas
good
people
question.
Say that Jesus is their Lord.
Good
he's,
question.
He's their Lord.
Good question.
It doesn't make sense.
Okay, I'll pick up those two points. Very good question. So why can he call God his Lord if he's not God himself? That's a great point. And again, it goes back to many Muslims have this misunderstanding on the Trinity. The way you've described it would be a modalistic sense, that one minute, you know, God's the Father, then he's the Son, then he's the Holy Spirit. So yes, you would have problems in that system.
Yeah.
That's the modalistic system. And the early church destroyed that system a long time ago. There are still Christians who have a misunderstanding on the Trinity, who may say some things like that.
Yeah.
But the early church, you know, they dealt with this in history. So how can Jesus call God Lord if he's God himself? Because we believe in what's called the hypostatic union, okay? Now the hypostatic union is the two natures of Christ. There's not two persons in Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
There's one person with two natures. For example, in Philippians, it says that Jesus was in heaven as God, but he entered human flesh, okay? In John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Now that could be translated, in the beginning was Jesus, the Word was Jesus, and Jesus was with God. If you go to verse 3, it says everything that has been created was created by Jesus. Do you understand?
Yeah, that makes
sense. So that goes back to my earlier, you was about to say it makes sense then, wasn't it?
No, you because can't you that. Said, you
yeah,
said
I understand,
that.
Yeah, I'm tricking you. Yeah,
no, I'm saying that it makes sense fine. What you're saying,
yeah, sure.
if that's what it,
yeah, sure.
you
yeah.
know?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
So in that sense, when Jesus says he's Lord, that's right to say because he enters human flesh. So when he enters human flesh, he's going to set a good example for his followers. Do you understand?
Okay.
So when he enters human flesh, as the second person of the Trinity, as we believe, he's not going to go off and do his own thing. He's not going to become an atheist. He's not going to become a Buddhist. He's going to continue that relationship with his Father. Do you understand? Which would at that time be through earthly means, like prayer, worship, and preaching.
Okay,
so that's how Jesus can call God his Father, because he enters human flesh. Now, you said that, that we call Jesus Lord, okay? That was your second point, wasn't it? We call Jesus Lord,
yeah.
even though Jesus called God his Lord. Yeah, as I said, I've answered why Jesus calls God his Lord, because as I said, his joint nature enters human flesh, carries on that relationship. But the reason why we call Jesus Lord is for the same reason the early disciples called Jesus Lord. Because you even see people in Matthew chapter 2, okay? They actually worship the baby Jesus. When he's born, the wise men come along, and when they find Jesus as a baby, it says they actually bow down and worship him, okay? Now, many Muslims tell me here that we should only bow down and worship God.
Yeah, of course.
I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
But if that's the case, why are the wise men bowing down and worshiping Jesus? We would say, because they recognize he's God.
Okay.
And we would also say, when the disciples bow down in the boats and worship Jesus, it's actually the same worship given to God in the book of Revelation. Do you understand?
So do you believe back then there was a lot of ignorance with people and they didn't understand things and they just, some people went on their own accord and some people done all their own thing? And secondly, that, you know, when how can he call upon himself? Do you know, that doesn't make sense.
It's like, explain that.
You said that he comes here as a human form, right? You said that God comes here as human flesh. Okay. One thing I say to that is, how can a God with such majesty and such power, okay, don't get it wrong, he has so much power that he could do that, but he wouldn't do that because that would then lower his majesty. Why would he then come as a human form if he tells you, I am the greatest, I am the creator of this world?
Yeah, sure.
Like, why would he then, he created us as humans, yeah? We live here, Adam and Eve, and you know? So why would he then lower his majesty to come down as a human form when he can come down as something way, way better than a human?
I understand. Can I address that?
Yeah.
Very good question. Very, very good question. And this is what really sets us apart in our faiths.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have a faith that tells you God wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Okay. But we have a faith that tells us that he done that for a reason. Because where we sinned, the fall of Adam and Eve, you understand this yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
Where we sinned, we have sin. Okay. So God is so loving, and we agree, God is loving, of course.
Yeah.
But I would say that the issue you have there is a false concept of justice and mercy, okay? So in the Christian faith, we believe God is both just and merciful, okay?
Of course.
So if God is just, he has to punish sin.
Yes?
Okay. He has to deal with sin, okay? If he's merciful, he's going to want to forgive out of his mercy, okay? So where at the incarnation is where both of these attributes of God, justice and mercy, both of these come into place, we see, in the incarnation, okay? And they both kiss at the cross, okay? Because at the cross...
Who kisses at the cross?
I'm going to explain. Okay. At the cross is where God's justice and mercy meet, yeah, without contradiction, okay? Because God did deal with sin in Christ, on the cross. That's why Christ came. He said he would shed his blood for many, okay? Through the cross, we have remission of sins, we are forgiven, okay? So he did deal with sin on the cross, he dealt with that, so therefore he's just. But he's also merciful, because at the cross and by the cross, to look to Jesus on the cross, we can obtain mercy. Now I would say the concept you have in Islam is, you can say he's very merciful, but I would say you can't say he's just, all due respect, because you have a God that sometimes forgives, sometimes doesn't. Do you understand?
Yeah.
So, and this even comes into play. Let me read you.
No, but he forgives and sometimes don't forgive. He forgives a person only when that person chooses to change his own self. You know, like, you can't tell me that I'm going to be mischievous in this world and I'm going to choose to kill a lot of people and just cause chaos in this world.
I understand that.
Yeah. And for me to be, this is how this is how God's mercy works. It works like this. I could be that person, right? But then I can have a different change of heart. I can always have that thing at the back of my heart that tells me, you know what you're doing is wrong. You need to change yourself. But at the same time, I'm too involved in this. But then eventually, it comes at the right time, you know? You got to remove yourself from that situation, yeah, for that mercy of God to be shown to you. Otherwise, because in Islam, it tells you, God gives you the choice, yeah? Allah, I call him Allah, you call him God. Same thing, yeah, but different, you know? So basically, what I'm trying to say is, he's merciful, yeah, and he's just, because sometimes what he does is, he even in the Quran it states, yeah, whoever don't want to believe, don't believe. Whoever wants to believe, believe. He gives you the choice, yeah, and that's why God created us with a conscience. He created us with a choice. You either choose to do good or you choose to do wrong. Some people are just so far gone that their soul's gone. They have no soul. They have a soul, but they're so far gone into the stuff they're into, like crime or violence, that they don't have no feelings, they don't have no appreciation, they don't care. All they want is take, I want. They're selfish, yeah? But then for a person to be like that and to change his aspect of life, that's a sign of mercy from God. Just God is always just,
let me address that. So again, why I say that you can say he's merciful, you can't really say he's just, okay? This is my opinion, I know you disagree.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, because I would even say that in the Quran, you have contradictory statements about his mercy, okay? Let me read you this verse, okay? This is Surah 4, verse 48, and it talks about the sin of shirk, yeah? It says...
This is in the Quran, yeah. Okay.
Indeed, Allah does not forgive association with him.
Yeah.
Okay, so you agree. Would you agree that that's the sin is not going to be forgiven?
Association with him means like...
Associating partners in worship.
Yeah,
yeah.
Exactly. So, okay, let's put it this way, yeah? Let's say the Queen now, yeah? She's the Queen of England, right? She then can't have someone right next to her saying, I'm a king and you're the queen.
Okay, let me address it.
Do you know?
I understand. You consider that association.
Yeah.
I get that, I understand. But we agree that's a sin that can't be forgiven, is that right?
Of course.
Okay, so this is the problem. You say it can't be forgiven because the Quran says that. But the Quran also says the opposite of
but
that.
But don't...
One second.
Okay, yeah, go on, sorry.
So if you continue in the same chapter, in verse 84 this time, it says, again, Allah forgives not that partners should be set up with him, okay? But he forgives anything else. So again, we see that reiterated, that this is the one sin he won't forgive.
Yeah.
Okay, that's too far gone, as you said earlier.
Of course.
Okay. But then in the same chapter, we see that very same sin that won't be forgiven, we see that very same sin actually being...
It could be forgiven.
One second, we see it being forgiven.
Of
not
course.
Could be. Because in the same chapter, but this time verse 153, we see it says, the people of the scripture ask you to bring them down a book from heaven. But they had asked of Moses even greater than that and said, show us Allah outright. So the thunderbolt struck them for their wrongdoing. Then they took the calf for worship. So they associated a partner with Allah in the form of this golden calf, yes?
No, they didn't do that.
One second, that's what it says.
He told them to slaughter the calf on his behalf for their sins to be forgiven.
This is the context of when Moses comes down from the mountain,
yeah.
He finds the Israelites. We have the same story in the Bible.
Cool, yeah.
Yeah, where they're worshipping the golden calf. That's what it says. Then they took the calf for worship. So they worshipped the calf, yes? After clear evidences had come to them, okay? And we know it was worshipping the calf.
Oh, yeah.
One second.
Okay.
We know it was them worshipping the golden calf because it says, and we forgave that. Okay, so in the very same chapter, you see two places saying this sin cannot be forgiven. Then you see their sin actually being forgiven. So I would say, in the Christian concept, forgiveness and salvation is very clear cut. It's straightforward, okay? It's a consistent message. I would say within the Quranic narrative, you struggle to find a clear cut way of salvation because you have contradictory verses that talk about salvation, but that's not the only point.
Of course, I understand.
Yeah, one more point.
Yep.
But not even just Muslims.
Yep.
When you talk about non-Muslims,
okay?
Because it says in the Quran, chapter 2, okay? Yep. Verse 62, it says, verily, those who believe and those who are Jews and Christians and Sabians, whoever believes in Allah and the last day, do righteous deeds, shall have their reward with their Lord. On them shall be no fear. Okay, so for the Jews, the Christians, the Sabians, and also the Muslims, there's nothing to worry about, okay?
Of course.
Yeah, okay, that's what it says. There's nothing to worry about, you agree. But then in the very next chapter, we see yet again another contradiction.
Okay.
In chapter 3, verse 85, it says, if anyone desires a religion other than Islam, never will it be accepted of him. Okay, so you see in the chapter previous, you see
that's
in the chapter. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
But what I'm trying to say.
One second.
Oh, okay,
so you see, that's fine. You see in the chapter previous, it says that Jews, Christians and Sabians, they're okay, there's nothing for them to fear. But then we see in the next chapter, actually, they should fear. So I would say, in one chapter, you have contradictory statements about what will be forgiven and what won't be.
Okay.
And then in regards to the Jews and the Christians and non-Muslims,
okay,
they have nothing to worry about. But then suddenly they do have something to worry about.
All right.
Do you get my point? So in Christianity,
so
it's
we
clear.
Believe
in Islam, it's
we
muggle.
Believe that God's creator, yeah?
Yes.
We believe he's the most majestic. Like he's
agree.
The top of the top. Nobody can overcome him, yeah?
Agreed.
Cool. So say, for instance, he's the top of the top. He is the top of the top, yeah? He's got the choice to forgive anything he feels like, whenever he feels like. Even if he states that he wouldn't forgive it, it's a choice of action. Like, say you, for instance, yeah? Say for you, for instance, because you got to understand, each book comes down to each generation in a different time with the same message, yeah?
I'm talking about the Quran.
I understand that it come in a different time, right? But what I'm trying to say to you is, these kind of things, like, you could not believe in God, right, for instance, yeah? Not believe, do whatever you want, freely, yeah? But there's a difference with not believing, and then not believing and oppressing someone that believes. There's a difference. So you can go around your life not believing, just living your life as in, yeah, this is my life, it's normal, we're just living, right? But then you could be a non-believer and then come and oppress me just because I'm a believer, just because I'm a Muslim. You could come, like, attack me or try and disrupt me just because I believe.
Can I interject?
Yeah.
But is that what the text said?
No, what I'm trying to say, I'm going to get to that.
Because you're telling me what your opinion is.
I'm going to get to that.
I'm just showing you what the Quran says.
Yes, I'm going to get to that.
Because like I said, we're not talking about people persecuting other people. We're talking about one sin being forgiven.
Of course.
And then the same sin not being forgiven.
I'm trying to say.
So, and then a group of people being forgiven and having nothing to worry about. And then the next chapter says the opposite.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
So each revelation come down in a different time, right?
Let me pause you there 1 second, please. So you're saying each revelation. I understand your point.
Yes.
But this is in the same revelation. This 1 second. This isn't in the previous revelation.
I understand.
This is in the same book. Okay. If you said this is in the Torah, this is Quran, you'd have a valid point.
No, what I'm trying to say.
But the fact that this is in the very same
Quran. Okay, cool. I understand. It's in the Quran. But what I'm trying to say is, yeah, God told them to choose the calf and sacrifice it, yeah?
No, that's not what
they
it says.
No, they chose to worship the calf. They chose to worship the calf. Because they asked him, at first they asked him, show us your creator. And that's a big mistake you can make, because nobody can see the creator until we die, until everyone gets judged, right? Right?
I believe in the incarnation.
Do you believe in deeds? Do you believe you get judged on your deeds?
Well, the Bible says that each man will be judged according to his work. That I don't think that's in terms of salvation.
That's deeds. That's what you do in life, good or bad, right? Good and bad, right? So basically what happens is you can have a little action that can change. Like, you can do something right, yeah, and it can change the aspect of how Allah thinks.
Oh, hold on. Okay. So the act of a human being can change the mind of Allah.
No, it don't change the mind of Allah, it can change the way. So at first he's telling you it won't be forgiven, right? But you can do an act, so it could be such a small act, yeah? Such a small act which a person will think it's not really worth nothing, yeah? But in the eyes of Allah or God, yeah, it's worth such a lot that just that one little act, yeah, can get you out of hellfire.
Let me address that. Again, I mean, you're a nice guy. I mean,
yeah,
this in the most respectful way possible. But you're giving me your opinion.
I'm giving you the attribute.
1 second.
Of God.
Yeah, I'm just telling you that the attribute of Allah is inconsistent with itself. Because, like I said, in one chapter, you see two different statements about salvation. In chapter 4, it says that sin, shirk, associating partners with Allah, it won't be forgiven, it says. Now, I know you're giving me your opinion.
Okay.
That is your opinion. I'm just telling you what it says. It says that 1 second. It says that sin will not be forgiven. Okay.
Okay?
Cool. But then a few verses later, it says that God actually forgave that sin.
Okay.
So
cool.
The problem is, you're giving me your opinion. I'm just asking you to deal with what the text says.
Okay,
because
cool.
Okay, let me ask you this. If I say to you, okay, yeah, I will not accept. Okay, let me ask you this. If I said to you, yeah, I will never accept your forgiveness if you do a certain thing.
Yeah.
If you punch me in the face, I will never accept you,
yeah,
okay? And then you punch me in the face 5 minutes later,
yeah,
and then I forgive you, would that be a contradiction? Yes.
Not really.
Explain
not really,
to me why
because
it's not.
You can't really compare the mercy of God compared to a mercy of a human being, because a human being judges you on anything you do. Whereas the difference between our creator, yeah, a human being judges you on an action, whereas
you said you're, God judges you on deeds.
No, he judges you on deeds, yes.
Is a deed an action?
It's an action,
it's
yes. But what I'm trying to say is, what a person judges you on. So say right now, okay, cool, I punch you in the face, you're going to judge me by that. You're going to be like, ah, oh, this guy is a bad person, whatever, blah, 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 without knowing me, right? Because I got angry and I acted out of anger, right? Whereas the mercy of Allah is He judges you on your deeds, yes, but He also judges you on your repentance, which has... Sometimes it won't matter about if you've done something bad, as long as you actually acknowledged it and repented towards it and actually asked for forgiveness, because that's what our Creator likes. He likes it when we come back to Him, and He likes it when we ask for forgiveness. Do you know? We're not just here to just do things and not ask for forgiveness. We have to ask for forgiveness. Otherwise, your deeds won't be forgiven.
Okay, so you said that just simply asking, simply repenting,
yes,
then you will be forgiven.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Again, that's not what the text says, because when we go to chapter 2, it continues this story. It talks about the calf being worshipped.
But that's what I said to you. I said to you, our mercy compared to our Creator's mercy is not the same thing.
Okay.
It doesn't matter what it says in the text, right? It says that in
it
the text.
It doesn't matter what the
No, it does. It does matter. But
calm
what
down,
I'm trying
okay,
to. No,
calm,
sorry.
Calm down.
What I'm trying to say to you, it does matter, right? But I'm telling you, it come down in different sections to different people and different generations. Back then, there was a lot of ignorance. Back then, there were people that wouldn't understand like how we understand, right? We live in a different century, like where homosexuality is all right.
Yeah,
things like that are all right.
Understand.
We understand, whereas back then, things like that would not be acceptable. Like you said, if I punch you in your face, you will never forgive me. It won't be acceptable, right?
I would.
But then if you did forgive me, yeah, that's different. Because our Creator's forgiveness, yeah, is compared to a human being that does not, we're nowhere near His mercy. We're nowhere near His mercy, because you said He's merciful, but He's not just. But how can you be merciful and not just? It doesn't make sense.
I agree, it doesn't make sense. That's the problem I'm bringing up. Let me address
okay,
your point.
Cool.
So
no,
you said that if, again, you've contradicted the Quran in a couple of times. Like I said to you earlier, those verses are clear cut. It won't be forgiven, then suddenly it is forgiven. Christians and non-believers don't have anything to worry about. The next chapter says, actually they do. Now, you're giving me your opinion and your spin, with due respect.
Yeah.
But I'm just giving you what the text says.
Okay?
So that's what the text says, clear cut. You can give me your narrative. And you also said that different revelations were given at different times. That would be acceptable if that revelation was given in the Torah and not the Quran. But that's not what we have. That same revelation that talks about that is the one book of the Quran.
Okay.
Do you understand?
Okay.
So you also said that if we just simply repent to God, He will forgive us, okay? I understand, but again, in that particular instance we're talking about, that's not what the text says.
If you carry on reading,
one second.
Gives you an option. He tells you what you need to do.
Shall I tell you what he
for
says?
Him to forgive
sorry,
you.
Sorry, sorry. You can't interpret the Quran.
In English?
English
you can't.
Well, listen, okay. So when Muslims interpret the Bible for an English translation,
no.
Do you need to learn Greek and Hebrew?
Yes.
Of course not.
Can I ask you a question?
Of course not.
Can I ask you a question?
No, once, you can come after.
Let me ask him a question. Can I ask you a question?
1 second, brother. Let me continue.
Okay, go on.
No,
let me ask him a question.
At the end of the day, I think that's inconsistent, because when Muslims attack the Bible, they don't have to learn Greek or Hebrew. But when I mention the Quran, when I mention the Quran, I have to know Arabic.
Question,
if you wish to come next, feel free. That's fine.
I'll answer his question.
You can wait till the end.
No, can I just answer what you just said? You just said something. You just said something. You said the Bible is written in Hebrew.
One second.
The Quran's written in Arabic.
One second.
That's what I'm going to get to.
We can get to that. Okay. You said that simply if Allah asks, if we simply repent to Allah, we'll be forgiven. But like I said to you previously, you have the verse that says that sin won't be forgiven. Then it says in the same chapter that sin was forgiven. So you have a contradiction in the forgiveness of Allah. It also says in chapter 2, like I'm reiterating, 1 second, let me finish, that the Jews, Christians and Sabians have nothing to worry about on the Day of Judgment. Then the very next chapter yet again contradicts that, because it says that no other religion will be accepted other than Islam. So you have two different contradictions in Allah's mercy and justice, okay? So I would say that the forgiveness of Allah is arbitrary, therefore not perfect. But you said
can you say that, God is perfect?
Yeah, 1 second. I don't believe your concept of God is perfect. Let me finish. When you said that if they repented of that, then they would have been forgiven. That's not what, again, if you read that story, go to chapter 2, verse 51.
It's not a story, to be honest
with
you.
No, one second.
Because chapter a story
two.
Is reading
listen,
a
listen,
book,
you can
right?
come next, it's fine.
No, you've just said
you
that.
Can
no,
come, you can come next.
I'm supposed to answer.
You've come after. I let him speak.
1 second, let him finish.
Thank you, I appreciate that, thank you. So you said that they just simply have to repent and they're forgiven.
Okay.
But again, that's not what the Quran says. Because in chapter 2, verse 54, talking about the very same act of worshipping the golden calf, it says, and recall, when Moses said to his people, O my people, indeed you have wronged yourselves by taking on the calf for worship. So repent to your Creator and kill yourselves. then it will be accepted of you. Now you just about to tell me exactly.
No, repent.
Because
repent,
one second,
you kill yourself.
That's what it says. Look, that's
listen.
That's,
like
that's what
said,
the, one second, brother.
Okay,
one second.
On,
I'm trying to be respectful.
Sorry, that's right. Let him carry on.
I'm not putting the words in the Quran. The words.
Let him carry on. Let him carry on.
Okay. So if you look at this.
Okay.
So repent to your Creator and kill yourselves. That is best for you in the sight of your Creator, then he will accept your repentance. So in that very act, you're saying, you can come next.
It's not come next.
I'm being respectful to you.
Let him carry on.
Notice, he's not interrupting his brother. He's interrupting me. You can come next.
Fine. You don't tell me what to do. When you're talking about a sentence, don't just pull out a sentence and just talk about that. What are you talking about? What context? What context?
Thank you.
Let me answer his question.
Yunus. Anas is being very respectful. Please, have some manners like your brother. Okay.
Have some. Everyone understand what you're talking about.
If you came earlier, you would have heard the conversation.
He's talking about
He's come too late into the conversation and said he doesn't understand the conversation. If you were here at the beginning, you would have heard the conversation. Therefore, understood it.
The Israelites said, show me Allah. And then when he sent the thunderbolt down, and then he said, he showed them the calf. The golden calf. That's what he's talking about.
Now let's continue. Like I said, so within that particular aspect, that one golden calf, it says it won't be forgiven, then we see it is forgiven. We see that Jews and Christians have nothing to worry about, then they do have something to worry about on the Day of Judgment. And then you said that if we simply repent, he'll forgive us. But there's a clause in that repentance. According to that verse, in that particular instance, it's, you saw the words there. I did not make that up.
Okay.
I'm not making this up.
Cool.
It says, kill yourselves, then he will accept the
repentance.
See, I say that's...
What verse is that, sir?
It's chapter 2, verse 54. Okay, so it says that you should kill yourselves and then he will forgive you.
Okay,
see,
cool.
the concept in the Christian faith about salvation and the just and merciful God is very clear cut. Like I said, justice and mercy meet at the cross and there's no contradiction because justice was done on the cross because God dealt with sin in Christ. God's mercy was also shown in that same act upon the cross. So when we look to Jesus on the cross, we can obtain mercy, okay? So God's justice and mercy kiss without contradiction.
Okay.
I'm saying this, that the aspect of the attributes of Allah, the mercy and justice, they overlap and they contradict each other.
Okay.
Do you understand?
Okay.
Because the forgiveness in the Quran seems arbitrary. So you can't make heads or tails.
Did God himself tell them go and worship the calf, or did they as human beings go and worship the calf?
That's not my point.
Yeah, but you're telling me they went and worshiped the calf, right?
Yeah.
Did God go and tell them to worship the calf?
No.
He told them to sacrifice them. No, he told them to look out for a calf, for a golden calf, right? What I'm trying to say to you is...
Not according to the biblical narrative.
According to the biblical... I'll explain something to you in Arabic, yeah? In Arabic, words in Arabic cannot be translated in English.
Okay.
The closest translation we can get in English to the Arabic, right? Because it's two different languages, like our vocabulary is different. Words back then would never translate into English words now. So then when you're saying it in English, the meaning in English has no meaning as the meaning in Arabic. There's a different meaning in Arabic, and there's a different meaning in... No, they're the same meaning.
You understand,
but what I'm trying to say is, translating it in English and translating it in Arabic, yeah? Like, if you were to read it in Arabic and read it in English, the English translation is like, when you write the Bible, yeah, they have
Let me stop you. That's only in the King James Version and the versions.
So how many times
that
has the Bible been rewritten?
Rewritten, okay.
Rewritten by human beings.
Okay, let me start. Okay, so the King James Version, as you alluded to, was not even the first English translation, okay? So the King James Version was published in 1611 and then revised in 1725 or something like that. There were Bibles older than that, like the Geneva Bible and the Bishop's Bible. There were Bibles older than that, you're absolutely correct. But we as Christians don't accept the same argument you just made. We don't say that the Bible has to be in Greek or Hebrew to understand it. Because we believe, one second, I've got the Greek on my phone.
Not to understand it.
One second. I've got the Greek on my phone, okay? I can show you what the Greek says. Now, if I was to read out the Greek to you in English, you'd be able to understand it perfectly fine, okay? Because we can, in fact, this whole story that you can't translate certain words, I'm sorry, I don't agree. Maybe not the words... One second, you don't speak Greek. So what I'm saying is this. Well, you can come next. So what I'm saying is this. Is that we don't agree with your terms that words can't be translated to have a correct meaning in another language. Because people have been doing this throughout history.
Pronunciation of words. Basically,
okay.
If you were to try pronounce a word in Arabic, yeah, it comes from different parts of the body. Yeah. Whereas in English, I could just talk English normal. Like, do you know what I mean? I don't need to like say it from
my nasal part, say it from my throat, say it from my middle throat, my lower throat. There's different letters and different words.
So does that mean we can't translate that into English? It can't be done?
You can, but the translation will be, one second, the translation will be the closest translation to the word. It won't be that exact word, but it will be the closest translation we can get to the
word.
So,
no, you can come next. So, one second. You've been saying this the whole time, one second. Lovely.
There's male or female. In English, if you say you,
Who am I speaking to?
No.
One person.
How about you stop interrupting the respectful conversation we're having and come next? How about that? You can have your turn. Just let me finish the conversation with Anis.
Standing here.
I'm not going against you, I'm just adding something.
Can I please continue this conversation without you heckling?
Just let him finish the point.
Well, why don't you want me to?
I'm saying you can talk, but please come next. I don't mind. We can make a line if you like. One second, brother.
In Arabic, there's male and there's female. If you're saying you, in Arabic, you say inta, into. You say it for male and female.
Masculine and feminine.
But can that be translated into English?
Let me finish. In English, if you say you, whether you're talking to a woman, whether you're talking to a man, it's this you. Arabic, you have male, female. It's different. It's not the same as English. Now you can carry on.
Fantastic. Thanks very much.
Would you stay on that point?
One second.
I'm going to forget his point otherwise.
Please.
I'm not going to stick to the point you mentioned about Arabic language.
Ben, battery change, yeah?
He's making a battery change.
Are
you rolling?
Yeah.
Okay, can I address that?
What did he say, Ben? Repeat for the camera.
Okay, let me address that. So, what's your name? Who? Waleed just said that to understand the Quran, it has to be in Arabic.
Yeah.
So ultimately, that leaves every non-Arabic speaker hopeless.
This is again,
like I said earlier, this is a distinction between the God that we believe in and the God you believe in. Because the God you believe in can only be understood in the Arabic language. One second. We believe in a universal God who can reach people in English, reach people in Spanish, reach people in Portuguese, reach people in Arabic. We believe that. So I would say that your God, you can come next. Okay, so again, I believe in a universal God who can reach people with his word in many different languages, okay? You guys are coming with this narrative that it can only be, not necessarily you, but the brother here. You're coming with this narrative that it can only be understood in Arabic, which leaves people who don't speak Arabic, which is most of the population of the world, hopeless.
But don't they have the choice to learn it?
You can come next, my friend.
They have a choice to learn it, yeah? Like, I know so many people, Spanish, German, wherever they're from, yeah? And they can talk Arabic and they've learned Arabic, they've got the choice to do it. But like I said, each human being, God created us with a conscience. He gave us a choice. He said, you can either do right or wrong. You can either choose this or choose that. And what does a human being do? You have the physical aspect as a human being to choose. Do I want to learn this language? You go to school to learn English, how to write, vocabulary, this and that, right? Whereas when you finish that, you have your own brain, you're older, you can travel the world, you can go and learn, you can do things. You have the choice again. That's back, going back to conscious. So you have the choice. In the Quran, it even states, you have the choice to either believe or to not believe. You have the choice as a human being. He's given you that aspect.
Okay.
As you've got a conscience.
So when you pray your five daily prayers, yes?
Yeah.
Do you believe that God accepts prayers that are in English? Not dua, the five daily prayers, can they be done in English and be accepted by God? He's saying no.
You can't say certain things which is like the shahada, which is the oneness of God. Like, you got to say that.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, one second, brother, the five daily prayers.
Whereas you can do it action-wise, without words, yeah, God accepts it. You don't need to say nothing. Okay. You can just sit there and do the action,
If you say those prayers in English, can they be accepted by God?
God's the most merciful, so they can be accepted by him.
So the brother here says
it's his decision.
Listen, at the end of the day, it's arbitrary.
As a human, yeah, you could disagree to things, but at the end of the day, the ultimate decision, yeah, is our Creator's. He can decide if he wants to accept your repentance. He can decide if he wants to.
It's invalid.
Invalid. So we have three different Muslims disagreeing.
We all agree that the five prayers have to be done at the time.
Sorry, who's interrupting? Say that again.
The compulsory
prayers have to be done in Arabic. Yeah. Whether you understand it or not, it has to be in, so it has to be in Arabic for that specific prayer. Those specific prayers.
This,
those
this are is five a problem. Specific this, prayers. This is a problem.
And the Prophet, peace be upon him, taught us how to pray, and it was like that in Arabic. So we do it exactly the way that he did it.
Okay.
But your personal supplications that you make, you can do.
That's why I said not to ask.
Yeah, but why is that an additional answer? Because that's what you guys do. That's your form of prayer, is supplication. So whatever you can do in your language, we can do in our language. But then additionally, we replicate our Prophet, peace be upon him, to pray exactly the way he did.
Okay. Let me get to that. Back to your point. You said, that it's up to Allah to forgive or to accept prayers, to accept repentance. My whole point in this discussion is, how can you trust, all due respect guys, how can you trust a God who is so arbitrary in his very forgiveness? Because as you may not have heard this earlier, but I pointed out where there's,
his forgiveness is extremely clear.
Brother, one second, it's not clear.
It's extremely clear, he forgives everything.
Okay, can I address that?
He forgives everything other than worshipping.
And that's what I said. Brother, let me ask you a question. You just said he accepts everything other than shirk.
Not accepts, he forgives.
He forgives everything other than shirk, okay, which is associating partners with God. Now again, all due respect, you've contradicted what the Quran actually teaches, because without interruption, please, in chapter 4, okay, verses 48, it says, as you said, indeed Allah does not forgive association with him, okay? So, and many Muslims here will teach this is the one sin Allah will not forgive, okay? This sin cannot be forgiven. And it goes on to reiterate this to make the point even stronger in verse 48 of the same chapter. It says, Allah forgives not that partners should be set up with him, okay? So in two verses in chapter 4, we see that particular sin will not be forgiven, okay? And that's quite clear. You all agree that's quite clear, yes? But there's a problem. It's not quite clear. Because in the very same chapter, just a few verses later, in verse 153, we see that sin that won't be forgiven was actually forgiven. Because in verse 153, it says, if the people of the scripture...
No,
let me finish.
Are you going to let me talk or...
One second. The people of the scripture ask you to bring them down a book from heaven. But they had asked of Moses even greater than that and said, show us Allah outright. Okay? And then it says, so the thunderbolt struck them for their wrongdoing. Then they took the calf for worship. Okay? That's associating a partner with Allah, worshipping something other than God himself, okay? But then it says, in contradiction to the previous verses, it says, and we forgave that. So you see there...
Did they die upon it? Are you going to let me finish? Yeah,
are you going to let me finish?
Yeah.
Okay. In that particular instance, okay, it was only forgiven of them if they killed themselves.
You
might say that's strange, but again, we pointed this out earlier, but for the sake of the brothers who have just got here...
Okay, hold on. Let me ask you a question.
You said, did they die on that?
Yeah.
Some of them actually did, because that was the only way they could be forgiven.
Okay.
So you said Allah forgives, and that's fine. That's fine. But again, bear in mind those verses in chapter 4, it won't be forgiven. Then suddenly that same sin that will never be forgiven...
Repeat it for the fourth time.
So again, I'm going back to the point he's making. He's making the point, Anas.
We're trying to answer you, you're not letting us answer you.
Anas is making the point that the forgiveness of Allah is crystal clear. I don't believe it is. Because, like I said, one chapter...
Can we answer you?
You can, when I finish my point. You can...
You're preaching or you're asking?
No, one second. You said, did they die upon that?
Yes.
One second. I'm asking you, one second. You're saying, did they die on that?
And if they didn't, everything's clear, yeah? Because everything else you're saying is like goes together.
One second, okay.
But this is the only bit that you disagree with.
But Allah gives a clause in the forgiveness and the repentance. Because in chapter 2, talking about the same story, in verse 54, it says that those who created the calf for worship, they should kill themselves, and then their repentance will be accepted.
Okay.
That's in your book. You said earlier, I read that.
Show me themselves. Yeah. Show me the interpretation. Kill themselves.
Ready. Kill yourselves, it says.
In Aaron, show me the Arabic.
Show me the Arabic.
What do you mean hiding? Arabic is the text.
So he's making the point.
Like I said earlier.
He's hiding behind the Arabic. Notice, one second. Let me say one thing. Can you just stop?
No.
Hold your respect, stop.
I'm not going to stop.
So if this individual was to say, you're panicking, this is panic.
What's panic?
This brother is very respectful.
All I want to do is have a say.
Take some manners from him.
All I want to do is have a say.
If he's his point, then you can.
jumping. When am I allowed to have a say? I've been here 20
but
minutes.
But he's debating him. He's debating your brother.
Let me put a point through.
Do you respect your brother?
I didn't go against him. I just put a point through. Yeah.
And the brother here.
I can ask you. Can answer your question.
Yeah, sure. Wait a second, brother. This brother has been very respectful. Please learn some manners from him. Okay.
One second. One second. Don't let us answer.
One second. I have to repeat myself because you keep interrupting every time I try to explain it. So if you just stay stum for a minute, you'll hear the argument.
Okay. Allah will forgive any sin. If you ask Allah, Allah will forgive any sin.
He'll forgive any sin.
Shirk is the highest sin in Islam.
Will that be forgiven?
One second, let me talk. Are you going to let me talk? You're just going to keep hit.
He's saying that's the highest sin and it won't be forgiven.
Just give him a chance.
No, he's not giving me a chance.
He's been here for
20 minutes.
Let him preach because he's telling us, he's not asking us.
In Islam, yeah. Allah can forgive any sin. Okay. If you kill 20 people and you ask Allah for forgiveness, Allah will forgive you.
Okay.
Don't ever go against Allah's wisdom. God knows everything.
Right. You want to address that point?
I'd love to address that point.
Okay.
Go on, answer.
You made your point, let him address it.
Right? Now you're going to use. Now, let me tell you what
you should. No, wait. No, you made your point.
Let me answer your question.
He's going to interpret the English to the Arabic wrong, and he's going to try to use that to defend.
This is shocking behavior, you have to admit. Come on. Have some respect.
Go on, mate. Go on, do your thing.
Just because you don't know it, listen.
But you're talking nonsense.
Let me change the memory card. I mean,
brother, one second.
Yeah, they can't be translated in English. They can't. They won't make sense. They don't make the same. They don't make the same like translation. If that makes sense.
All right, we're running out.
Forgive. I'm saying that the forgiveness in the Quran is contradictory. Sorry, I missed that. Yeah, I said the forgiveness in the Quran is contradictory. So yeah, so the brother said there that he's basically making the point that the forgiveness of Allah is clear cut and crystal clear. Now I'm making the comparison to the Christian faith, that the Christian faith is quite clear in terms of salvation. Our soteriology is very clear. I'm making the point to Anas, that the concept of salvation, the soteriology, the doctrine of salvation in the Quran is arbitrary and contradictory, because in certain places Allah forgives us, Allah does not forgive a sin. The sin of shirk will not be forgiven. Then it suddenly is forgiven. The Christians, Jews and Sabians have nothing to worry about. The next chapter says actually they do have something to worry about on the day of judgment. So I'm saying that in your book there are contradictory statements about salvation.
Okay.
In my book it's quite crystal clear.
Do you know who, when he says, yeah, he's referring to a certain amount of people. Like when he says, okay, they don't have nothing to worry about, he's talking about the people that worship. Whereas when he says they have something to worry about, he's talking about them people that choose to live their life.
That's interesting.
Whereas, yeah, another thing I wanted to explain to you about this Arabic and English thing, right? In English, Arabic, any language, there's grammar, vocabulary, all of that, right? That's in every language, there's vocabulary. Whereas sometimes in Arabic grammar, some words in Arabic grammar cannot be translated in English. Whereas what I'm trying to say to you, in an English translation, Quran, they will choose the closest translation word to the word, whereas it won't be the same. As in when you read it in English,
will the meaning be the same?
The meaning won't be the same because.
So then, what's the point of an English translation of the Quran?
It's because it's for people that can't read Arabic. Whereas you try and get the closest words you can.
But notice what you said. But notice what you said. You said that it won't be the same meaning. But they should.
No.
One second. You said that it won't be the same meaning as the Arabic, but yet they should still read it to understand the Quran. How does that make sense?
It's like,
how do you square that circle?
All right, cool. It's like, you're English, right? Someone that can't speak English, right? If you were to read him something and translate it to him in his language, it will mean a different thing.
No.
Absolutely
no.
Different.
Okay,
yes, it would.
Okay.
The words will be so different. It won't mean the same thing. It might mean a little bit, but it won't mean the same thing. It won't have the same effect as it would in that language.
It absolutely does.
It won't.
Let me give you an example. Garçon, a conta por favor. That means, waiter, can I have the bill, please, in Portuguese, yes? That means the same thing as it does in
English. We're talking
in
about
English.
Godly words, not human words.
Well, hold on.
Human words.
Hold on. Define what you mean by godly words and human words. Because do you agree that God speaks to people through human understanding? Words, English words, Arabic words, Spanish words.
I agree to that.
Because you just said it's godly words. What's the difference between a godly word?
No, whereas majestic is so majestic that you can't compare it to us You can't compare it to context of our context. Okay, so it's like we speak slang and we speak posh. If I was to go to a posh person and speak my slang, he won't understand it. Will he understand? If I said to him, Wagwan, bruv, what are you saying? Is he going to understand that? He's probably going to understand, what are you saying? He's not going to understand Wagwan.
It can be translated, but it's not going to mean
the same thing.
Of course it will. Okay, you say Wagwan, whatever you said, yeah?
Yeah.
That means what's going on, yeah? What's happening? What are you doing, yeah?
Not really. It can mean so many other things as well.
Okay. Can it be translated to mean the correct word you're trying to have come across?
You're not understanding by majestic. I just said majestic. Yeah.
Okay, 1 second.
You're comparing words like this.
Okay, so if your argument is it's so majestic, therefore it has to be from God.
Yeah.
Now, would that make sense in any other argument? For example, if I say that Mozart's music is so great, I cannot compose music.
Well, look
Mozart,
where you're going. You're going to music. One second.
The analogy is valid. So if I say that Mozart's music is so great, no one can make music like Mozart. Therefore, that's the inspired music of God. 1 second, my brother.
I beg of you. Please, let me just get one. I did not interrupt you.
Okay, that would not make sense to say it's the inspired music of Allah. Now, if, for example, even if you say the Quran's a perfect book, still doesn't mean it's from God. I can write a book with absolutely no errors whatsoever, no spelling, no grammar, no mathematical, no scientific. Does that mean my book's therefore from God?
No, because it's human.
If you're interpreting it, it's different.
Exactly. And I would say that the evidence that the Quran is human made, all due respect, is these contradictions I previously pointed out.
It's human made, yes, but it's written word for word, accent for accent. Not a single line is wrong. Not a single word, letter, grammar, vocabulary, nothing is wrong. Whereas the Bible's been rewritten by different kings.
Can I put one point and I'll let you two carry on? Ben, I'm so sorry.
Let me address this point. Okay, well, let me address this point. We can talk about the Bible. I'm happy to do that, okay? So, you said that, what did you say previously? What was your first point?
About the grammar.
Yeah, okay, so the grammar is this, that and the other. Okay, but does that mean it's therefore from God?
No, but what you're not understanding, in the Arabic language, you don't learn vocabulary, you learn grammar first, yeah? Which is what? How words are pronounced, how to say them correctly, where they come from a certain different part of the body, not nasal, okay. You know, throat, okay.
Just to show
that you can translate something from Arabic to English, what does assalamu alaikum, what does that mean?
Peace be upon you.
Can I just say one thing? One second. So, if that's okay to translate, I mean, guys say that all the time here, assalamu alaikum, walaikum salam, all this type of stuff. You can translate those words into English, but why is it when we get to difficult passages in the Quran, therefore it has to be in Arabic?
This book here was written by three American women, International, even they say there's errors in this book. Sahih International.
One second, let me talk.
You're not going to let me talk again. The most out there book, Quran, is the Abdullah Yusuf book. He wrote it for 40 years. It took him 40 years to translate Arabic to English. That's the most used book. Yes. It took him 40 years to write down this, what you got in front of you. He says there's going to be errors in it.
Okay.
The three women that wrote Sahih International, this actual book you got in front of you, they say there's so much errors in this. They say themselves. Now, who are you, the reader that's reading this, to tell me this is 100% true? It's not. You can never translate Arabic to English. Never. Okay. Like I said, there's male and there's female. English, there ain't male and female. If there's a woman here, if I say you, move out, it's the same thing. Okay. But in Arabic, there's male, there's female. There's so much different things I can tell you. You can't interpret it the same. Now, these three women are converts. They're converts that wrote this book. They're converts. They come to Islam. These women that wrote this book, they're converts. You get it, yeah?
Okay, cool.
Now, this book, you can't, it's not, has it, there's errors, there's errors. That's it, case closed. Now you two, carry on, mate.
For Hashim, she'll speak. Go get Kay, she'll do it.
That's all I wanted to do.
Address his point.
Okay, so the point he made was that, by the way, I do agree. There are mistakes in the Quran. Those three women that said there are mistakes
in the Quran. Not in the Quran, in the translation of the Quran.
I agree, there are mistakes in that book. I totally agree. One of the mistakes is the contradictions, okay? So, like I said, and you said earlier, the Bible's been translated. Yes, we believe the Bible can be translated from Greek and Hebrew into English and be perfectly understood fine.
Ben, I said it's been rewritten.
Ben, it's like you becoming Muslim. It's like you becoming Muslim.
Right, we just draw this back. Listen, let's close up. We are disagreeing. My whole entire point in this discussion was salvation in the Bible is quite clear. when in regards to the Quran, you see, as I said earlier, I know you disagree, I'll let you have the last word, okay?
Yeah, no problem.
But the Quran teaches that the sin will be forgiven, excuse me, it teaches that the sin won't be forgiven, then the sin will be forgiven. It teaches that, for example, that Jews, Sabians and Christians have nothing to worry about on the Day of Judgment, then it says they do have something to worry about.
Okay, cool.
Okay, one second. So that's my point. My whole entire point is the Quran contradicts itself in terms of salvation. So my point is this. Why do you trust a book that cannot make it up its mind with when particular sins are involved?
Okay.
Because I can't trust a God who says this sin will be forgiven and then it won't be forgiven.
Okay, so do you believe some things that are written in the Quran in this century?
Use that in a minute, that's what I'm asking you.
Do you believe in the Quran?
I'm going to get a drink in a minute to my fight. And then
Okay, bro.
You said you've read the Quran, right? In the English translation.
I have the English translation.
Do you believe that some of the things that are in the Quran now are happening now in this day and age?
What's that relevant to the point?
No, what I'm trying to say, do you believe that?
That's not relevant.
Do you believe that though? Do you believe that some of the things that are written there in the English translation are actually happening now?
This is talking about something that happened in history.
In history, but is happening now as well.
In
it's
what context?
Reoccurring.
Like what?
That prostitution, things like
oh, yeah,
that, all
regard,
of that thing,
yeah.
People killing each other, people blowing up each other, things like that, people being evil, kings, rulers, killing people just to be in charge, yeah, that's still happening now, right? Cool?
Yeah.
Back to the point, yeah?
What does it have to do with the contradictions?
Back to the point, yeah? What I'm trying to say to you, you're saying it's contradicting the mercy of Allah, yeah? The mercy of Allah, first of all, yeah, is He's the most merciful. Yeah, he's one of his attributes.
Do you trust
names,
his mercy?
Yes, I do.
But one of
his
wait,
let me finish. One of his attributes, yeah, and his names is the most merciful. When you're the most merciful, what does that mean?
Anything.
You forgive anything.
Yes.
Back to the point, yeah. Association with partners with God, he said he won't forgive it, right? And then you said he says that they have something to worry about later on.
No, no, that's two different things.
You're
conflating two different things. That they're not having anything to worry about is the Jews, Christians and Sabians. They're not forgiving shirk, for example, like the golden calf.
Yeah.
That won't be forgiven. Then it was forgiven. So you're conflating two different things.
No, okay, cool. Okay, cool. What I'm trying to say to you is now, yeah, is you're saying it wasn't forgiven, then it was forgiven. And then you said, yeah, they have something to worry about, then they don't have something to worry about.
Two different concepts.
One thing that brother said, yeah, if they die upon it, so if I worship an idol now, I've associated partners with God, right? If I die upon associating that partner with God, because if God had a partner, if he had partners, don't you think they'll all want to fight about who wants to be the king, who wants to be the ruler?
Do you think that when the Quran talks about partners with God, do you think it's talking about...
It's talking about idols, it's talking about everything.
Can an idol fight against God?
It's talking about everything.
Can an idol fight against God?
Of course not, because it's man-made.
Then your point's irrelevant.
It's man-made. No, it's not irrelevant because people made them to make people believe that this is God. Why? Because they benefit from it and they gain from it.
Can it be forgiven, yes or no?
What's that?
Associating partners with Allah.
No. If you die upon it, it can't be forgiven.
Okay?
No, one second. You're not understanding my point.
I'll let you finish.
It can be forgiven if you repent your sin.
Okay, so all you have to do is just say, I repent.
No, you actually have to show remorse.
When you're
taken to a police station and they're interviewing you and you're under arrest for something, yeah, and you're in court or something, if you're not showing remorse and guilt or feeling sorry for about the action you've done, do you think they're going to forgive you? They're going to be like, no, this guy's still on his same thing. Whereas, for God to forgive you for real, like I said, you have to transform your human. You have to change yourself.
Okay.
You have to choose that, okay, I've done something wrong. I'm hoping that Allah forgives me and He will forgive me because He states that He will forgive you if you repent.
If you repent.
Yes.
Okay, so that's all you have to do is genuinely repent.
Genuinely, which means,
I've done an action and I won't do it again. I know what repentance is. So why in that verse, in chapter 2, does it say that their repentance will only be forgiven if they kill themselves? That's what the text says. You saw
I said to you, in English and Arabic.
You hide behind the Arabic.
No, because you're not understanding. If you understood Arabic,
If you understood Arabic,
a word, like
asking
I said,
what self means. It says kill themselves. What does selves mean?
Kill themselves, yes.
What does self,
yes.
What's your idea of a self? What do you mean by the term self? From a theological perspective, yeah, religion, in Christianity, what do you guys see as the self?
Can I answer that?
Yes, please.
When it says kill yourselves, it's talking about the guilty among them, okay? So you're saying that that doesn't even help your situation, because when it says kill yourselves, I agree, it's talking about killing the guilty among them who worship the golden calf, okay?
That's what I'm saying.
One second, okay. But even if that's the case, it still won't be forgiven unless that killing takes place. So you're just saying that it's just genuine repentance. That says it's repentance and the killing. You're saying it's the repentance. I'm saying no, that verse says it's repentance and the killing of the guilty.
What does it mean by killing themselves? What does self mean to you in Christianity? You didn't. What is, okay, one sentence, what is it, would you, what does it mean by the self?
By killing themselves. Well, it can either mean suicide, or it depends on the context, because words only have a meaning in a given context, okay? So killing themselves...
It says kutilu enfusikum, killing themselves, yeah? So that means themselves. And yeah. So now we're saying, what does the word enfusihim mean? What does that mean? What is singular form?
Killing themselves, there's only two ways to look at this. One
nefs,
second.
Yeah? Nefs. So what do we mean by the nefs? So when we're saying killing the nefs, what does that mean? Do you know?
Killing themselves, which means soul.
Okay, so
they change themselves.
No. It says killing themselves. Then it will be... But ultimately, this story is taken from the Bible, okay? Because the guilty among the people were killed in the Bible too. That wasn't a case of you have to do this, then your repentance will be forgiven. Those who worship the calf could have repented and be forgiven. This says that they would only have been forgiven if they was to kill themselves. Now that could mean killing the guilty, or it could mean actual suicide.
No, self. When you say self, yeah, you mean as in a human form, as in I commit suicide with my human form. When self means nefs in Arabic, yeah, which you're saying self means a soul, your inside self, not your outside self, which means I'm just gonna go jump off a building or something and kill my whole body.
So how can a man kill his own soul?
Own soul, whereas you stop doing the bad things you've done. That's what I'm trying to explain.
Notice you're saying something the text doesn't say.
No, but you're not understanding. This is where it comes back to grammar in Arabic and English, whereas you're not understanding.
Listen, this conversation's gone on too long. I'll let you have the final word.
No, that's right, there's no final word. Thank you very much for this. Yeah, I appreciate it.
Nice one, bro. Thank you, bro. Subscribe to the channel. Yeah, nice
one,
bro. Okay, nice one. Thank you, man. Soko, S-O-C-O Films.
S-O-C-O Films.
Yeah. Soko Films.
Thank you, yeah.
Thank you, buddy. God bless you, bro.
Brother.
Quick wrap up.
You're not sincere, though. You don't want to know.
I'm very sincere.
But you're trying to say...
Wait, one last question. One last point. Man.
Just forget the camera as well. Just on a
Let me do this, and you can ask. Okay, so my whole point was this. Is the justice and mercy in the Quran and the Bible. When you look at the Quranic narrative, it's very messy. Some a particular sin will not be forgiven, then it is forgiven. The Jews and the Christians and Sabians don't have anything to worry about on the judgment day, but then in the very next chapter it says they do have something to worry about, because only Islam will be accepted. So if only Islam will be accepted, what was the point in telling the Jews, Christians and Sabians that they were A-OK? That's a contradiction. Now also, when you look at the biblical perspective, we have two attributes of God that meet without contradiction. The justice of God and the mercy of God met and kissed at the cross without contradiction, because the justice of God was done because he dealt with sin at the cross. The mercy of God is also shown because at the cross we can obtain mercy. When we look to Jesus and we believe in his redeeming work upon the cross, we can be forgiven. So these two attributes of God meet without contradiction. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Praise the Lord.